commission, should you decide to accept it.
Self-destruct in 5 seconds. Good luck.
Good morning, First Church. I'm Becky Imhauser. I'm one of the pastors here, and I'm delighted to be with you today to share God's Word. We've already had such a wonderful, abundant service, but we're going to add some more right now by talking about how we can continue to go on mission. When we learn to read, many of us learn to read with short, repetitive words. Some people learn to read with a book series called Dick and Jane, Adventures with Dick and Jane, and you'll see a book cover up there that exemplifies using a short, repetitive word that's a powerful concept. Go, go, go. The word go is a powerful concept in God's Word. It appears throughout the Bible as a way to motivate us to be His hands and feet on earth today. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute, but first, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for giving us your will and your wisdom and your power to be a going people. I thank you, Lord, for the ways we've seen you move and be at work in this service already. I thank you, Lord, for the opportunities that are set forth for us. And as we consider ways that we can go this morning, I ask that you would speak to us individually and remind us of your promise that everywhere we go, you go before us, you go with us, and you go after us. In your name we pray. Amen. We've been talking about being on mission and how we are called and how our mission is not impossible with a tape that destructs. Our mission is possible through the power of Christ. And Pastor Christopher and Pastor Candace just returned from a huge go. You'll see a picture of them on the airplane. They went to Africa. Now, we may not have the wherewithal, some of us, to go on a plane to Africa. But God still calls us to go really close to home. We can go by opportunities here. We're going to take a look at those this morning. But as inspiration for our own going, let's look at how God talked to people in the Bible about going. Moses was one who went, as was Noah. And I'm going to start with Noah. Noah is one of the first instances of being told to go in the Bible. You know the Bible story, and you may have seen the movie about God protecting Noah's family from the big flood that was going to happen and destroy the earth. The Bible tells us, the Lord then said to Noah, go into the ark, you and your own family, because I have found you righteous in your generation. God protected him and enabled the world to continue through him. Moses was called to take God's children out of bondage. And Moses, like some of us perhaps, was not really a ready person to go. Moses had a litany of excuses. And if you read those in the Bible, you may say, oh yeah, that's how I feel, uh-huh. And then you continue reading and see what God said to Moses. God said to Moses, so now go. There's our word. He said, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. And that did happen. But Moses didn't get to see the people all the way out of Egypt and into the promised land. That was picked up by Joshua. And the book of Joshua is filled with encouragement for us as we go. Because Joshua faced a scary task. He had to go to a land where there were giants, physical giants. And we know that we face giants in our own world. He had to cross a river that was at flood stage. And sometimes we stand on a bank with troubled water in front of us. God stilled the water for Joshua. They crossed over. And God repeatedly told Joshua, as we see in the words on the screen, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. And if we take one thing out of the message today about going, let it be that. The Lord our God is with us wherever we go. Paul in the New Testament provides an excellent example of us about going. The concept of go is throughout the New Testament. Jesus' ministry, he often healed people, performed miracles, and then he said, go tell people how you're changed. He does the same for us. He works in our lives, and we're to tell people how we're changed. But today, for the sake of illustration, we're going to go on a short leg of Paul's missionary journey. And it will be somewhat in the dark, but that is symbolic. Pastor Canvas talked about our need for light in the sanctuary. But I picked out some cities here that are significant in Paul's missionary journey, just as prompts for us as we consider our own missionary journey. The first city is Antioch, and that is where Paul began his ministry. That church kept him in its prayers. He kept that church in his heart throughout his ministry. First church, we are Antioch. We are Antioch for Chloe this morning, who was baptized and who said she feels called to be a pastor. We are Antioch for Aaron Douglas, who right now is preaching at one of our partnership churches, Bethel UMC in Hughesville. And in a God wink, my Antioch was mentioned in the pastoral prayer. We pray for a different church and a different school each Sunday. And out of all the churches that we pray for throughout the year, this week's church was Mount Hermon Baptist Church. That's where I grew up. And that's where I did what Chloe did. I went forward at the end of a service and I said, God is calling me into some kind of ministry. And as a result of the prayers of that church, my Antioch, I'm here today. And two members of that church were here last night. That was a nice surprise for all of us. So Antioch was always near and dear to Paul's heart. He continued through several cities. He went to Paphos. And at that point, he encountered a little bit of opposition. And I only put that here to remind us, even when we are on mission for God, that doesn't guarantee that it's going to be always smooth sailing, because God sends us to people. And people are people. And there's going to be maybe a few things that we need to depend on God in a special way to work through. Now, by the time Paul got to Pisidian Antioch, his ministry was gaining traction. Good things were happening. People were wanting to hear him speak, and he was beginning to see fruit. And when he was in this city, he preached his longest sermon that's recorded in the Bible. And so I thought there was no other way to recreate Paul's missionary journey than with a long sermon today. And I will pause there while you all listen to me say, no, that's not going to happen. This is really a short sermon, shorter than the three other services, because we had so many good things going on in the service beside it. But Paul had good things happening there. Paul learned a pattern in these previous churches that when he got to Lystra, he broke. Paul started, when he went to a new city, he started his ministry by being in the synagogues or in the churches. That's where he started. When he got to Lystra, he began going out of the churches and into the marketplace. He chose the marketplace because the marketplace is where the people are. Think about us. When we leave this church, if we were going to the marketplace to where the people are, it could be a variety of locations, but that's a way that we spread God's love and what he does in our lives outside the church. I first learned about going outside the church while I was in the church, and you're going to see a picture here of my early church experience. I'm third from the left with my mouth wide open. Always. I started young. We were doing an exercise, one of those things as an older person that's still imprinted on my mind. And this is what it was. I don't know if any of you learned this. Here is the church. Here is the steeple. Open the doors and see all the people. The people are in the church. But my teachers, those on either side of that picture, were quick to tell us the people, the fingers. And as a child, I tried to give those fingers name, and I knew more people in the church than I had fingers. That was perplexing. But the people don't stay in the church. The people go outside the church to mission and to serve Christ. And we have many, many opportunities in our area because Sedalia has a strong heritage of mission work. You know I love history. And I won't tell you very much today, but I'm just going to share a few things. You'll see a picture of the YMCA. And that is one of the first initiatives that Sedalians came together after the turn of the century. And they built a new building in 1911 with contributions. YMCA, Young Men's Christian Association, primarily was to reach young men, because young men, they thought, often caused trouble. And if we got the young men straightened out, maybe the rest of the world would follow. To the point that one of the main people in the YMCA formed a boys' band. And the boys' band was provided instruments, provided uniforms, performed across the city and at other functions. And it was founded by a physician who had the theme for this boys' band: he who blows a horn will not blow a safe. So that was how that all began. He thought he would prevent crime with that. The next decade, in the 20s, there were so many safes being blown, truly, there was so much crime, that the city came together and founded something called the United Fund, which was known as the Community Chest initially. And that's the forerunner of some of the ways that we can begin to serve today. I'm going to take us on an example of a missionary journey we might take in our community. And again, solely examples. There's so many, many things out there that we could be doing. United Way is one organization that grew from the community organization, that grew from the United Fund, with the principle, its founding principle was that we can do more together. If we come together to raise funds, we'll save time, we'll save time fundraising, and we'll have more to give to help people. United Way, incidentally, is kicking off this month, and one of its themes is things that go. We're things that go. Here's another couple that feed people. Very, very basic needs right there. Open Door has a variety of ministries. It has a cafe, it has a service center, it has a food pantry, and then it also is able to provide services to people like who are without power or without funds for overnight stays, a lot of things. Community Cafe is near and dear to many members. I see people here who serve there. I've served there. It provides a nutritious evening meal for free for those who need it. Another community way. Our next stop on our local missionary journey is going to be the Senior Center. The theme, we're continuing to feed people. The Senior Center feeds people at the Heckert Center and also delivers to those who are homebound. Meals on Wheels is another delivery organization in Sedalia, volunteer-based. The beauty of those is that sometimes when someone brings a meal to a house, that may be the only contact that person has. They receive a meal, but they also have what my husband and I call eyes on, as we've done elder care. They need have somebody who put their eyes on and see if they have a need besides food that can be met. These two, for our last leg of our local journey, I'm excited to say these are homegrown. These are First Church initiatives, and you'll be hearing a lot more about Tiger Eyes, which is our partnership for mentoring and snacks in the Sedalia School District. You'll hear about that from Pat Sturgis in a couple of weeks. We also have a coat ministry that provides new coats, brand new coats, to Sedalia and the Pettis County school area. Pat Ives is the founder of that. And I talked with both women this week. They told me heart-touching stories that I don't have time to share today. But listen as you can, and more importantly, become involved as and if you can. We've chosen this month to focus on Matthew 25, which is on your screen, because this is why we do what we do as missions. The verse says, "For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me." And we do all that because Jesus said, "Truly, I tell you, whatever you do for one of these, you do for me." And that's how we go on mission. We've learned from our missionary journeys some principles that you'll see on your screen. First, we're to go as God calls us. Be responsive. Even if we're scared, that's okay. God's with us. Go with the prayers of believers. Go with the prayers of the people at Antioch. And that's us, First Church. That's us. Expect results as you go. Go expecting challenges. That's being real. Go as a mentor and go as a team. Several years ago, I was part of a team at a local church, and we had a Bible study group that decided to do a mission project. And in our Bible study group, we had newer attenders who had come from a safe home or safe place in Sedalia where they were doing a recovery work. And they were required to come to church. We had to sign their worship guide to show that they'd been there. They became more comfortable and more responsive through the weeks that we sat together in Bible study. But we sat in a circle of chairs. And no matter what we did, they didn't want to sit in our circle of chairs. We would talk before and after class, and everything was great. But they had some challenges about their self-image. They didn't feel like they were part of that circle. We would add chairs, and they still wouldn't sit in the circle. They'd pull the chairs behind the circle. Easter time came, and we decided to do a mission project for a local organization where we collected things for mission baskets for kids, for Easter baskets. They were mission baskets. They were Easter baskets. And the day we brought in our bags with things that we had purchased, we just spontaneously put them in the circle. And I looked around, and out of the corner of my eye, here came our men friends who'd been unwilling to be part of our circle, but they had shopped. And they were people that didn't have money. We prayed for a lot of them as they re-entered the workforce. We prayed for them when they were needing before the workforce. We helped them during those times. So they didn't have a lot to spend, but they shopped for the mission project. And the most beautiful part of that was not that they shopped, but that when they put their bags in the center with ours, they returned to chairs in our circle. Those empty chairs we'd had in the circle all those weeks, knowing that someday we would be united. That's what happens when we serve together. You were handed a card when you came in that looks like this. And if you don't have it and you can't see to read it in the dark, the words on the back are printed on the screen. It's a great commission. The front of it has a road, like we've talked about today. That's our road. That's our mission road. That's our journey. And it has a sign that says, go. That's the city you're headed to. You don't know what it is, but God does. And it also says no limits, because it's important that we know there's no limits to what God can do. So let's close by reading aloud the Great Commission. And when we come to the word go, let's shout it out and make people in the parking lot or across the street wonder what's going on in here. Are you ready? Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the end of the age. At this time, we will go for prayer. This is your opportunity if you feel like you'd like to come forward and ask for prayer, for something good in your life, for a challenge, or in the context of what we're talking about, for God to guide you and lead you in a new mission. I'm going to ask Pastor Gene Page if he would come stand at this side, and I will be on this side, and we would love to pray with you.